Hi, my name is Florian Krause, and I'm a PhD student at the Chair for Electrochemical Energy Conversion and Storage Systems.
Hello, my name is Lucas Asberg. I'm from the Institute for Hearing Technology and Acoustics.
My name is Fabian Brinks. I work at the IWE1 Institute of RWTH Aachen University. And as you all know, today is Star Wars Day, and this is why we're going to break down some scenes of these iconic movies.
To the First Order, and will remember this as the last day of the Republic.
Transfer to manual control.
Configure.
So what we see here is the Starkiller base. It's not like the Death Stars in the other films, like a space station. It's more like a converted planet here, and so it's a bit different here. What we just saw was the big laser weapon they have there to destroy planets. And what they did was they dug out until they reached the inner core of the planet to install the weapon there. And for powering up this weapon, or for the energy source, they're actually using the sun's energy from nearby. At least that's one theory. So I just did like a little research or a little quick math there to see how much energy is actually needed there. And if we just simply assume that our sun is like in one day, generating like 4 multiplied 10 to the power of 17 watt hours per day. That's actually quite a big mass. And if we compare that, like actually we cannot use every energy from the sun, which is being generated, because we just simply don't have the technology yet. But if we compare this to how much energy we actually can generate in total by now, like that means oil, gas, and electricity, and so on, then we can generate 7 multiplied 10 to the power of 13 watt hours per day, which is actually far away from what we need there. It's like the factor 10 or something in between. So what that means, if we just use all the energy we have to charge up that kind of weapon, that would probably take us like 27 years. I guess that's a lot of time, and in those 27 years we cannot use any other energy for, like, I don't know, cooking or stuff. But just imagine we have this map, this weapon, and we try to store the energy for this. Then again, there's the question, how do we store it? Because the weapon itself doesn't look like an energy storage. So what they did there, by digging out the whole planet to the inner core, they used actually the magnetic field of the planet to store this energy. But this kind of technology we do not have. So what we actually have is battery storages. For example, just recently announced by Tesla in their Model S, they have 85 kilowatt hours storage power, or the battery is that big. So if we do the calculation there, that means we would need 5 billion Teslas to store that amount of energy. And also that means after 27 years, all of those Teslas had to be fully charged. And if we distribute this fairly, I mean, I would like to have a Tesla, but everyone would like to have one. And if we have 5 billions, or if we need 5 billions, each person could have one. Not only one, it's more like 600 Teslas for each of them, for each person on Earth. So I wouldn't know where to store those 600 Teslas, but again, I don't want to destroy other planets. So that's a big difference. And then again, in the movie, they're actually not talking about our sun. So the sun they're talking about is like 3 million times bigger. So that's even a bigger number of cars or Teslas we would need there. But at least they use renewable energy, I guess. So why do I talk about battery storage systems and Teslas? Actually, that's my part of my field of research at the chair, and all of us are actually trying to improve those batteries. And as we can see, just 86 kilowatt hours is just not enough. I mean, for a Tesla it is, but as soon as it comes to different applications, we definitely need better energy storage systems. And that doesn't mean it has to be a battery. There's like also other chemical storage systems. And that's what we do at our chair.
Stand by. Saturn charges. Stand by.
So, what have we seen here? In this scene, Obi-Wan chases Jango Fett with his spaceship and is able to track him down despite this hyperjump. But for me, a lot more interesting is what have we heard? I think this sound design here is especially impressive. We noticed this explosion of this so-called seismic charger, a space bomb, which has really a remarkable sound design, which helped me to remember the scene back from 2002 when I first watched this movie. This scene, although it is acoustically very interesting and very nice to hear for us, it has nothing to do with how sound propagates in space in reality. So whenever we have no atmosphere, no gas, or no matter, sound is not able to propagate. So Obi-Wan in his cabin of his spaceship wouldn't be able to hear anything from the space bomb explosion. He would just notice any sound when, for example, a particle or a part of the asteroid would hit his spaceship. In 2021, we just had another mission where the Mars rover's Perseverance brought the first microphone on Mars and provided the first audio recordings from Mars. At the Institute of Hearing Technology and Acoustics, we also research the propagation of sound. For example, we are interested in how the ideal classroom sounds like, or how an old church sounded a couple centuries ago. We also research the simulation of electric vehicles or airplanes and investigate the impact on our well-being.
The blast doors!
So, that was a pretty impressive scene, and as most of you probably know, lightsabers are a very iconic part of all of the Star Wars movies, and the science behind the blades of the lightsabers itself has been, well, discussed pretty extensively, let's say. You can't really study it since it's science fiction. But today we're actually not going to talk about the blade, we're actually going to talk about the energy storage. So a lightsaber is of course inherently a handheld device, and as you all know, for any electronic handheld devices that we have available today, be it smartphones or laptops or really anything, they are limited by the amount of energy storage that the battery inside the device can provide. And making such a cut, just like Qui-Gon just did, would actually require huge amounts of energy. You can actually calculate how much energy that would be from pretty much basic physics principle. We can assume that the blade of the lightsaber is approximately 5 centimeters in diameter, the door is approximately 20 centimeters deep, and the cut is approximately 2 meters long. That gives us 0.02 meters cubed of material that has been cut. And if we assume a density similar to that of titanium, we get around 100 kilograms of material that have been molten away by the blade. And from the coloration of the molten material, which you can see is somewhat yellowish white, we can estimate that the temperature has to be around 5000 Kelvin. And using the mass and the temperature that the material has been heated up to, we can actually calculate how much energy would be required to heat a material to this kind of temperature. And that actually turns out to be about 250,000 kilojoules. And if we now assume that it took Qui-Gon approximately 10 seconds to make this cut, this puts us at a power output of 25 megawatts, which is surprisingly close to the power output of the nuclear reactor on an atomic submarine. If we now assume that a lightsaber might be able to operate for a couple of hours before the battery needs to be recharged, that would put us somewhere in the order of tens to 100 megawatt hours of energy that is stored inside this small energy cell, inside the hilt of a lightsaber. And if we compare that to the battery inside your smartphone, which clocks in at about 10 watt hours, this means that a lightsaber energy source has approximately a million times the capacity that a regular smartphone battery has. So you would be able to operate it for approximately a million hours, which, yeah, not even your grandchildren would need to recharge their phone anytime soon at this kind of energy storage capacity.
Okay. Did you get the wire out? The red wire. No, the red one. Show me the red wire. The red one. Yes, good. Now, you're going to plug that red wire where the blue wire goes in the board. Put the red wire where the blue wire goes in the board, okay? But don't let them touch. See where you took the blue one off? Yes. Now, put the red one. No, don't put the blue one back. Put the red one where the blue one was, and put the blue one where the red one was. But be careful. They're oppositely charged, so keep them away from each other. Make sure you hold them apart from... No, hold them apart. Are you okay?
Okay. I think every electrical engineer has started once like that. Hopefully not with a normal electric power line, but with a battery.
Now I finally understand how my supervisor must have felt while instructing me during my master thesis.
Yeah. Funny scene. Reminds me of my first day at work, like when I did my first time as a heavy in one of the institutes. I'm happy that I didn't destroy anything, but that could have happened easy to me as well. So I can feel him.
I hope you enjoyed watching, and may the force be with you.